Sorry, so sorry.
Okay, just to be sure that all the participants came back after this short break. So, well, just let me introduce you very briefly Minerva Sada, that will give a talk answering the question, can synthetic methodology cause a paradigm shift? So, please, go ahead.
Okay, so thank you for waiting for a long time, not short break, long time. So actually, as I'm giving my lecture in, from University of Tokyo in Japan, the same Japan, but different place from Osaka. Anyhow, the title of my today's talk is Can Synthetic Methodology Cause a Paradigm Shift? This is the same title of the workshop that Luisa invited me in Italy. Okay, anyhow. So it's actually, I'm the professor of the Osaka University, and also some principal investigator. But also, I'm a board member of the Japanese Society of the Baby Science. So why I'm doing the baby science? So my answer is a very simple one. Because, you know, we like to make the robots much more intelligent. But what's the intelligence? That's a big question. So big question is how the baby develop, you know, and then learn the different behaviors. So the mystery, maybe, you know, we may find that during the baby, how the baby develops. So instead, you know, also we can utilize the robot to study, to understand how the baby develops. So therefore, I'm working for the board member of the baby science. So anyhow, first of all, I like to just the brief introduction of the RoboCup 2013. This year, it was held Eindhoven in the Netherlands. And we got the 410 teams and more than 3,000 participants and 1,500 visitors we got. And this shows some change of the teams. We started in 1997, and these days we have more than 400 teams around the world. And due to the limit of the space and time, so we just accepted these the teams of these numbers. Anyhow, so this is some picture of the we got my team the collaboration with other Osaka Institute of Technology, the team Joytech. We got the winner of the human league on the adult side, and also the best human cap and so on. Anyhow, so this shows some outline of my talk. So I spent so much time for the break time, so I should hurry up. Okay. So first of all, I like to mention how the human developed. Okay. So I was born in 1953, and this year I became the 60. And in Japan, the 60 is some kind of celebration, return to the baby. So therefore, this year's birthday, my colleague held the party for me to celebrate my 60th anniversary. Okay, anyhow, so this is a joke. So this indicates how the baby or the fetus in the womb is doing. So the horizontal axis indicates the number of weeks after the conception, and the vertical axis indicates several different behaviors. And you can see that, so we're around 10 weeks, so the sucking and swallow happen. And about the sensation, touch starts around 10 weeks. And then around 20 weeks, some vision and auditory started. So even though not very accurate the vision system, but the fetus react to the stimuli, the lighting, stimuli of the lighting from outside. And after the birth, so the infant learned so different behaviors. For example, at 5th month, the hand legal is to look at the hand. But this means kind of the forward and the inverse models of the hand. So the learning target from a viewpoint of the robotics is that forward and the inverse model. Or a 6th month, the fingers, others, face, and so on. And 7th, the drops object, and so on. And 8 months, 9 months, 10 months, the imitation is very, very important, the behavior of the baby. And just 1 year after the birth, so they have some behaviors of pretending. So, for example, the telephone or something, same thing. And this means some kind of the mental simulations. So we gave up because, you know, we cannot build such a robot who can obtain the so different behaviors just 1 year. So there's some big mystery. So someone says that, you know, okay, this is not learning, not a big mystery. The gene holds all kinds of information. But the big argument, the very famous classical argument was nature versus nature. But nowadays, the nature, you know, the Matt Little, he published a book, Nature by Nature. Because, you know, no longer it is nature but by nature, nature versus nature. Nowadays, nature side and the nature side so closely related to each other. Therefore, no longer it is nature versus nature, but nature via nature. So, the one thing we have to care is the balance between the nature side, to what extent we have embed some structure, and how much we can expect, you know, the learning from the environment and so on. So, you know, today I like to focus on the synthetic approach, synthetic methodology. So, I suppose, you know, I believe that the synthetic methodology has a big potential to reveal some big mystery of our development. Okay, and also, I like to propose a paradigm shift. So, usually the existing disciplines of the science, usually based on the philosophy of the, you know, explanations. But what does explanation based on the observation and analysis limited to the available data? But how can we conquer this limitation? That's one challenge. So the paradigm shift is that from the philosophy of the explanation to the philosophy of the synthesis, that's the design. So in the past, you know, of course, we have some kind of a similar approach. For example, the systems of biology try to, you know, reveal the mystery of the biological system by using the computer simulations and so on, so on. So our question is that, you know, analysis-based approach from the gut viewpoint. So we may have the two whole difficulties. One is how to understand the living things, the biology, so many sub-disciplines. The recent progress of the most advanced technologies, but more and more microscopic cues, scopic such as molecular biology and so on. And second point is how to understand the human beings as a social agent that involves the psychology, the cognitive science, and the sociology. So the interdisciplinary approach is an essential one. So the question is it impossible by integrating the existing disciplines? And we are advocating the cognitive developmental robotics as completely independent from them or not. Of course not. So the point is that by involving the existing disciplines, the cognitive developmental robotics should give its significance by prospecting the limits of the existing scientific disciplines. So the point is that we integrate the knowledge, the evidence, and the findings utilizing the existing paradigms and the synthesis, and not to deny the existing disciplines, but to involve them. Therefore, the cognitive developmental researcher should have the minimum amount of knowledge in these disciplines and build a model of the hypothesis that have no contradiction with the existing disciplines or reserve the contradiction or controversial issues. This is a key point for the cognitive developmental robotics researchers to hit on an idea that reflects the integrated knowledge in one. And third, to find a new factor that provides a solution to a mystery through the verification process of the model or hypothesis by simulation or real experiments. So the common issue is, you know, body representations, reasonable timing, multimodal input-output, division, touch, something, and self-other separations, sociality, acquisition, and so on. So what's a sufficient condition? So if the cognitive developmental robotics can provide the constructive and unified form of the representation that can explain and simultaneously design the cognitive development of these issues, so a new value of the paradigm shift. To enable this, the studies of the development disorder may help the unified model construction of the cognitive development. So I'm sorry that the order is the reverse. So the cognitive development robotics is aims at the understanding of the human cognitive development process, and its key idea is the physical embodiment and social interaction through the that enables the information structuring through the interaction with the environment, including the agent. So the physical embodiment is not a new term. So actually, the 1 year before my birthday, so Roger Spelly mentioned the importance of the physical embodiment. He mentioned that to understand the mind begins with the patterns of the motion, motor activities, and derives underlying mental... Oh, sorry. What's happened? Okay. Oh, okay. Ooh. Can I see? Okay.
Minoru, okay, Minoru, I take the opportunity to tell you that you can go also at a slower pace. We can wait, I think. It's an extremely interesting talk, so you don't need to shorten it. Huh? In our interest. Okay, okay. Thank you. Thank you again.
Okay, so I try to speak slowly. Okay. But actually, I have more slides. Okay. Anyhow, so this is the physical embodiment, and Roger Spelly, he is a Nobel winner, the famous for the split brain. The left hemisphere and the right hemisphere behaved the different personality or something. But anyhow, so he already mentioned about the importance of the physical embodiment 61 years ago already. The second point is a social interaction. So this is, Alban Noe. He is a young philosopher. And he mentioned that the mind cannot be understood except in time of, again, it was disconnected. I'm trying. Just a moment. Okay, just a moment. Okay, now? So this young guy mentioned that the mind cannot be understood except in terms of the interaction of a whole organism with the external environment, especially the social environment. So the title of his book is Out of Our Heads. So many brain scientists suppose that where is our mind? Maybe in our brain. But, disconnect again. Just a moment. Okay. Now, can see? It's okay? Okay. So the point is, this is very, very important. Because, the many brain scientists suppose that where is our mind? Maybe in our brain. But, Alban Noe mentioned that not inside our brain, but outside. But outside means there is some interaction. So through the interaction, something mind may happen. But suppose that if we send one single robot to the moon, so that this robot does not need to emerge the mind something. But if we send one more robot or one more humans, so in that case, the robot should communicate with humans. So this is a big potential. So even though we have some kind of internal mechanisms, but through the interaction, there is some possibility to emerge something, some dynamic system may happen and emerge some kind of, you know, sort of the mind or something. So the, you know, so even he is a young philosopher, but the point is that, you know, between the interaction, through the interaction with the two brains or two bodies, there's a big potential to emerge some kind of the sort of the mind. Therefore, we suppose that two robots, or one robot and one human, but interaction is very, very important to emerge some sort of the, you know, that the mind. And that's my paper. It's a cognitive development seamlessly connect the physical environment and the social interaction. This is actually a survey of the 4 years ago. So this picture indicates some summary of my former project, starting from the fetus simulation that has been done by the Yasuo Kunishu's laboratory, and also the dynamic movement based on the artificial muscle. It's a Machiavellian type pneumatic actuators. So the pneumatic actuator is very, very difficult to control. But instead, this makes the interaction much more richer. Because some kind of, you know, suppose that some fixed, some electric motor drives, you know, the robot such as Honda Ashimo or something. We like this one. Not so dynamic movement. But the, you know, pneumatic actuators, you know, it's a component movement like this one, or very rigid, you know, a high stiffness, it might be okay. So by using this one, the professor co-host of the group embeds a different kind of the robots. For example, there's some baby robot, the clawing or the walking, and so on. On the other hand, so the based on some imaging studies, we have done also some kind of the self as a discrimination or the tool use and so on. And after that, some kind of social interaction, for example, the bowel limitations, the joint attentions, and the emotion sharing and so on. So often I was asked the question, how can robots physically grown up? Of course, in our same group of the beta type robotics people doing some study about how to emerge, how to evolve some sort of the vision, the eye or ear and so on, but it takes so long time, and also the big money. So therefore, we prepared different kind of these other platforms depending on the age. And depending on the age, the different research focus is we focus the different research topics depending on the age. But just a moment. But my former project is by dividing the age, we didn't do some very, very consistent way of the development. So the new project, we focus on the some development of especially the self as a cognitions. So the synchronization with the own body and gradually with the environment, object, and caregivers, and desynchronization with other persons. That's the basic idea. So this indicates some, roughly speaking, we may have the three stages of the development. The first one is some ecological self. So the newborn baby, and then they interact with the environment, or object, and so on. And through these interactions, probably the newborn baby obtained some representation of its own body and some kind of interaction with the object. And the second stage is the interpersonal self. And then gradually, the caregiver interact with her baby. So the baby, suppose that, at the beginning, so the caregiver's body is my own. Because, caregiver try to, disconnect it? No? Okay. Okay, now it's okay, right? Okay? Okay. So in the second stage, so the caregiver first enters as a baby's body. But gradually in the world, a different style, because, you know, the caregiver try to encourage the baby, the independent or something. So this is, you know, the period of time. So where the baby starts thinking about the, some concept of the self and non-self or self and other. So this is kind of the, you know, some infrastructure of the mirror neuron system. And the third stage is a social self. So where, you know, already is a self as a separation established. Then after that, you know, the you know, agent or the baby can switch, interact with the mother, and they desynchronize and synchronize the father and so on. So at this moment, at this stage, the baby can do the control the switching, the synchronization versus desynchronizations. This is actually the rough sketch of the, some internal mechanisms. And at the beginning, just harmonize or synchronization. And second stage, maybe some kind of inhibition or the turn taking happen. And third stage, much more control of the switching. So in this figure, so the purple part is added and the gray part is added at the final stage. But probably we expect that some mechanisms automatically emerge this new structure to emerge some, you know, to enable some development process of the self from the, you know, ecological self to the social self. So this is an overview of the my whole project, of the new project. So we have some, you know, the brain development, the simulation, computer modeling, and so on. And the left side is a brain functional imaging. So we have the researchers of the functional MRI, MEG, EEG, and stuff. And the right side is where the behavior observation or some psychological experiment to verify the model or something. And the robot platform have the, these three groups. So these four groups are, you know, closely interacted. And sometimes the brain imaging study suggests some model, or the model group asks the, you know, imaging group to verify the model or something. So the one of the issue is that so some sort of the, you know, the mind. So the usually the empathy and sympathy often confusing used. So the mind definition, I suppose maybe the mind definition completely opposite the, you know, some Western definitions. But that actually that I asked my former colleague, he is German, and he checked my English. But he mentioned that the German definition of the empathy and the sympathy are completely opposite. But anyhow, the point is that besides the difference in the usage, the key component could be a sort of emotional state to be shared, and the way to represent or manipulate it might be different. So this could be clearer when we attempt to design it for the artificial agent. So we start from the metaphor and the evolutionary study of the non-human primate to apply it to the artificial empathy. So the point is that, you know, not the clear definition of the empathy and the sympathy, but so the design issues, how to design some, you know, artificial mind or artificial empathy and so on. So one metaphor is that I forgot the, from whom I had this story, but let me explain. So medical doctors can infer the distress of the patient, and that's empathy, my definition, don't care, my definition. That's perspective taking, and they can do adequate operation to do reduce the distress of the patient, that target helping. However, they often face difficulty to do any operations when the patients are their own sons or daughters. That's a sympathetic concern. That's my definition. So in case of the empathy, so indirect mapping, so the knowledge base or something. While in case of the sympathy, so that some sort of the direct mapping. Maybe the German people, you know, opposite definition. But anyhow, this is my definition. So this indicates some kind of the evolution of the empathy of the, some primate researchers, non-human primate researchers thinking. So right side is, you know, some evolution of the imitation. Oh, again. Okay. Okay. Just wait, just wait. Okay. Okay, so in case of the empathy, so at the bottom is the emotional contagion. So PAM stands for the perception action mapping. That's usually we say the sensory motor mapping and so on. And the middle is the sympathetic concern or consolations. And finally, the top, Really? Okay. Okay. Okay now. Okay. Okay, sorry. So the top is empathy. It's a passive taking, the target helping, and so on. So this guy is the human parameter researcher mentions that empathy is the final one, but sympathetic concern is just middle. So we assigned in some kind of a stage. So the perception action mapping is just kind of physical embodiment in the bottom. And the second stage is a cognitive and affective development. And third one is a social mind by social interaction. So starting with some emotional contagion and sympathetic concern and finally empathy. So So towards artificial emotion. So we're starting, disconnected. So sorry. Can you see? It's okay? Okay. So starting primary emotion, that's the emotion we share with other animals. So the pleasant, unpleasant, or sleep arousal. Or much more fundamental one is the fear to avoid the enemy and so on. And the second stage is the cognitive and affective development. So this is starting with the differentiation of the primary emotion to more social ones. As I mentioned, the primary emotion is the pleasant and unpleasant. But gradually through the interaction, these primary emotion could be differentiated to the more social one, happiness, sadness, and anger, and so on. And the third stage is evolution of a social and virtual emotion. This is very, very human specific. So as a species, as an animal, just a primary emotion. And some non-human primate may have a little bit some, social emotions. But only humans have some more social and virtual emotions. I mentioned later. Okay. So one of the example of the human specific one is that one. The sad music induces a pleasant emotion. Actually, this is not our work, but Professor Kazuo Okanoya's group's work, and focuses on the emotion, evolution of the emotion. Anyhow, so the title of this paper is that sad music induces pleasant emotion. It may no wonder, it seems no wonder for everyone, because everyone has some experience of the listening of the sad music. But actually, what kind of mechanism, underlying mechanism, enables this kind of situation is not so clear. So the sad music would be perceived as sad, but evoke the present emotions. So where the perceived emotion and felt emotion is different. Sad music, of course, sad music. But I enjoy, this sad music. So a kind of the contradictions. Actually, they measures, some kind of the emotional state. So although sad music was perceived to be the more tragic, but listening to sad music actually induces the participant to feel more romantic and bleater and less tragic. That's a very, very interesting story. And then the media reacted. So her paper actually focused on the New York Times, the BBC Radio, and also Oliver Sacks mentioned this study. So why this is interesting? So the empathy and the sympathy again. So the sympathy, as I mentioned, is a direct mapping of others' emotional state to self's one. That's self and others' non-discrimination, not so much discriminated. On the other hand, the empathy is non-direct mapping of others' emotional state to self's one. So self as a discrimination is already. The above cases, the same or similar emotional states, sad, happy, and so on. But in case of the sad music, the opposite emotional state happened. So self and others more discriminated. So what's the development process of the ABAP? I suppose maybe, you know, the kids, maybe they cannot enjoy the sad music first. But gradually they start to enjoy the sad music, the listening sad music. So depending on the experience of the world, the falling love or something, so that they start gradually enjoy the world, the sad music or something. Oops, game. Just a moment. It's okay? Okay. So point is that, you know, as I mentioned, so only humans, I suppose maybe, you know, some the companies, you know, the commercial film shows that the monkey listening to some music. But actually, you know, listening to the music is very, very human specific. So the human evolved, you know, some emotional state, not simply the sympathetic or empathic, but also, you know, completely at a different state. So this is some typical aspect. It seems to me the typical aspect of the, you know, concept on the self and others, and also the, you know, the memory too. Okay, the discussion is that the relationship between empathy and sympathy can be projected to the data of the perceived and the felt emotions. So this implies some kind of underlying mechanism of the brain functions. So the question is, for me, the development of the emotion is also related to the development of the self as a cognition. Okay. And to do that, recently we built a world of the affect, so new, much more realistic baby robots to study, you know, some emotional interaction between the baby and the caregivers. Of course, you know, the baby is very, very difficult to control. Therefore, we build up this kind of robots, and to start, you know, studied how the caregivers react to this realistic, the baby robots, and so on. So today is so much trouble over the, you know, the connections, and I'm very sorry. And today I just, you know, mentioned about our concept and our future study about the artificial emotion, the design of the artificial emotions. But these members of the, you know, my colleagues, and I appreciate these guys, and thank you for attention. I'm really, really sorry to disconnection of my talk during my talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Asada. Okay, so is there any question from the audience or from social networks or all the way we have to interact? Okay, actually I have just a curiosity more than a question. And we saw this effect of sad music. Did you plan to do some other experiment on your point of view, so in cognitive studies, to see if this kind of effect on empathy and sympathy, also by changing also the deepness of this sad music, or maybe good music that can maybe do the opposite or something like that?
Yeah. Okay. So the, as actually now what you are planning the lovely two stages. One is, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, no problem.
It's okay.
Yeah, no problem.
Okay. Okay. So the one of the issue is that so the paper, the study is just only the in the world some the behavior the experiment, so not the you know, inside. So the first one is that we try to verify this hypothesis by using the imaging study, how the brain, which brain lesion, you know, committed to the, this kind of process, probably you know the amygdala or some brain lesion, you know, involved in this process and some kind of the interaction of some. This is the first one, and the second point is, as I mentioned, probably the kids, maybe you know they cannot enjoy the certain music at first, but they gradually enjoy. So we try to you know find which age or which situation change the you know some kind of the this situation. So maybe also we have we may have some kind of the functional MRI study for the kids, because you know we already passed the ethics committee to study the you know, functional MRI study for the kids. Therefore, roughly speaking, the imaging study for the adults to verify the, this hypothesis. And the second one is just for kids.
Okay, thank you very much. Is there any other question? Okay, thank you again to Professor Minerva Sada. And I don't know, the scheduling now, how can we come back to the original pathway? We can go ahead with the next speaker, or we can plan a short coffee break.
Matteo, I think we should organize something like I think it's a fit 15 minutes break, because we still have to do
break.
Some forward test.
Okay, that's right. So a 15 minutes break, and we will start again hopefully at 11:35. Okay.
Excellent.
Okay.
Minora, many thanks to Professor Azada.
Yeah. Okay. So sorry of the big trouble.
No. I mean, the content was great as usual. So.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks. So actually, I have another appointment of the so we're, I have to leave in maybe 10 minutes. So if you have any questions after my lecture, so please send me the email, and then I will try to answer. Thank you. Thanks so much.